Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Read to Lead, The Simple Habit That Expands Your Influence and Boosts Your Career by Jeff Brown and Jesse Wisnewski. Narrated by Jeff Brown and Jesse Wisnewski. Dedication from Jeff. To Matt Austin Schuff and Seth Godin, who, though they've never met, teamed up with one another in 2003 to help reignite my love for reading. To my mother, Peggy, and my late father, Joseph, for an incredibly loving childhood, and to everyone who has ever listened to the Read to Lead podcast. Without your support the last 8 years, this book would simply not exist.
Dedication from Jesse. To Jessica, my beloved, you fill my life with love and the words to write. To my children, Peyton, Jude, Elizabeth, Jonah, and Evelyn, I pray you pick up and carry on a love for reading.
Introduction. Why read a book about reading books? Today a reader, tomorrow a leader. Margaret Fuller. Considering you're reading a book about reading books for professional development, it's likely you already value both of those things. Regardless of whether you're a non-reader, sporadic reader, or bibliophile, or you are early in your career or a C-level executive, listening to this book tells us you're interested in improving your reading, sharpening yourself professionally, or progressing in your career or business. It also lets us know you either feel stuck or you're looking for some tips in taking your reading, influence, and profession to the next level. But you don't know what to do next. You have questions. Will books help me to improve myself? What books should I read? How can I apply what I read? Is there a way I can remember more of what I read? How can I read faster? Is listening to audiobooks or reading book summaries enough? Thankfully, you're in the right place. Books can transform you as a person and professional, and the act of reading itself possesses the ability to improve your decision-making skills, increase your intelligence, and open up more opportunities among several other benefits. To milk the books you read for all they're worth, all you need to do is capture a vision for reading and learn a handful of lessons on choosing what to read and how to read. Afterward, you'll be well on your way to creating an unchangeable reading habit that will fuel your career and business. In this book, we're going to tell you how. Before getting into the details, let's get a few things out of the way. What does it mean to read to lead? As President Harry S. Truman said, "Not all readers are leaders, but all leaders are readers." There's way more to reading to lead than strictly reading leadership books, though they certainly can be on your reading list. Reading to lead is more about how reading itself can make you a better son or daughter, friend, coworker, manager, entrepreneur, or an overall better human being. As you read books in general, you'll better understand people, improve your decision-making skills, sharpen your ability to communicate, and become more creative, which are all essential characteristics of the modern-day leader. Does this mean I should only read whatever book I fancy at the moment? Nope. Far from it. What you'll hear in the following chapters are the benefits associated with reading all sorts of books, including fiction and books you find entertaining. What you'll also discover are ways you can identify nonfiction books you should read to learn skills and how to nearly master anything through the books you read, along with a few tips on how to reinforce these lessons. So, reading to lead includes a combination of the act of reading and what you read. As you read and read books related to skills, disciplines, and characteristics relevant to your work, you'll be better positioned than others to take the lead in life and business. Special skills are not required. Reading books requires one skill, reading. For millions of adults in the United States, this is a challenge. There's no need to feel ashamed if this is you, nor is there any reason to judge someone else who has this problem. Later, we'll cover reasons why someone may be a non-reader, and if this is you or someone you know, there's help available. Assuming you're able to read, you don't need to acquire additional skills to reap the benefits from books. You don't need to take out a ginormous student loan, you don't need to obtain a high-priced certificate, and you don't have to stop working or going to school to read more books. At times, this may be what's best for you for different reasons, but don't shy away from reading books and enjoying the benefits they provide. In your career and business, often you make tremendous strides or discover new opportunities from reading books. And as you'll hear later, there's really no comparison between the cost of books and the return on investment, ROI, they provide compared to an expensive degree, graduate school, or certificate. Start reading anytime. Haven't read a book in months, years, or decades? No sweat. You can start reading more today. I, Jeff, didn't pick up a book for a 12-year period spanning my 20s and 30s. For Jesse, on the other hand, the first book he read on purpose was when he was 20 years old. We're not alone. Countless others have discovered later in life the joy and benefits of reading books. As you ramp up your reading regimen, don't copy the reading habits of someone else or feel like a failure if you're not reading dozens of books or more a year. Focus on creating a reading plan that suits your needs and fits with your season of life. Later, we'll show you how. Fight away regret. Don't compare yourself to others. Start reading more today. Your future self will thank you later. Reading lessons and tips in one place. Between me and Jesse, it has taken years of reading, a couple of courses, research, and interviews with hundreds of authors to come away with the lessons contained within these chapters. We're not tooting our own horn. Instead, we want you to know you can reduce your learning curve, maximize your reading, save yourself time and money in learning, and position yourself to progress professionally with the lessons in this book. We'd love nothing more than for you to take these lessons, apply them in your life, and succeed at whatever work you do. How to use this book. Here are three ways you can get everything out of Read to Lead. Number one, pick and choose what you listen to. We wrote Read to Lead in such a way that you can choose whatever chapter you want to hear. Ideally, it's best to listen to the first part, why you need to read books, in order to capture a vision for reading, but the chapters can be listened to individually. If you must, or if you're pressed for time, feel free to skip around and see what resonates with you and get to work. Number two, use this book as a reference. Several of the chapters contain lessons you'll need to practice and helpful tips you'll need to use before reading your next book. We recommend spending as much time as you need when it comes to building a reading plan, creating a reading habit, and increasing your reading speed. It will also be helpful to refer to Chapter 8, How to Absorb a Book into Your Bloodstream, before you read a new book to prepare yourself to comprehend and retain what you read. Number three, download these resources. Throughout this book, you'll hear multiple resources mentioned that you can download for free. You can wait to download these resources later, or you can go ahead and visit readtoleadbook.com/resources to see what's available and access them now. That's all for now. Let's get started.
Part 1. Why You Need to Read Books. Chapter 1. Why You Need to Read Like Your Career Depends on It. Reading is essential for those who seek to rise above the ordinary. Jim Rohn. Man, not again. The thought raced through my head. The writing was on the wall. I was working for a nonprofit organization as a copywriter, and the organization was going through internal changes. I had a hunch my job would be phased out. Not knowing if I was going to have a job twisted my stomach into an awful knot. My family and I had just moved to Washington State from West Virginia so I could take this position, and now the security of my job was fading away. It's hard to live life, do good work, and provide for your family when your job security is in question. For a while, I just hoped for the best. I continued to perform my duties faithfully, and like a wannabe professional poker player, I hid my stress, kept my cool, and held my cards close to my chest. But the fear of not knowing was too much for me to bear for long. So, instead of waiting to be acted upon, I decided to take action. Since I wanted to stay with the organization, I started to look for ways I could make an internal pivot. I was on a quest to discover a different job within the organization. Thankfully, I had an idea of what that might be. When I first accepted my position as a copywriter, I was new to the field. I had a breadth of writing experience, mostly in academic papers, trade books, and blog posts, but I wasn't adept as an ad man. To get myself up to speed, I read several copywriting books. I'd adjusted to classics like The Adweek Copywriting Handbook, Ogilvy on Advertising, and The Copywriter's Handbook. I also explored several current titles. Reading these books exposed me to new ways of sharing messages, reaching people, and building a brand. While I enjoyed the art of writing, through reading I developed an interest in the science of managing and marketing a message. Coincidentally, I learned there was a potential role for such a job within my organization, a job in content strategy. However, I wasn't ready to make a transition. I knew I needed further training to prepare myself, but I ran into two significant problems, time and money. At this period of my life, I was still in graduate school pursuing a religious degree. I didn't have the ability to pursue additional coursework. I couldn't give up my current studies, and I wasn't sure how long my job would last. What is more, being married with four kids at the time and working for a nonprofit organization didn't leave me with any time or money to spare to take classes or online courses. After ruling out a few ideas, there was one last thing I knew to do: hit the books. Before I approached my organization about my interest in learning more about content strategy, I learned everything I could about the topic within a few short months. The year was 2013, so there wasn't a ton on the market, but I did find several helpful books, such as Content Strategy for the Web by Christina Halverson and Melissa Rock, Content Strategy for Mobile by Karen McGrain, Clout by Colleen Jones, The Web Content Strategist Bible by Richard Sheffield, Content Rules by Ann Hanley and CC Chapman, The New Rules of Marketing and PR by David Meerman Scott, Managing Content Marketing by Joe Polizzi and Robert Rose. Hungry to learn a new skill, I devoured these books. I chewed on every last word, digested new concepts, and took what I learned to build a proposal. By spending a little more than $100 on books and many hours absorbing their content, I gained the confidence and skills I needed to make a move. I shared my idea with my supervisor, who liked it. The transition went smoothly, and I was able to pursue different work within the organization. Were it not for the knowledge I gained from the books I read, I would not have been able to make such a pivot. Through no fault of my own or ill will from the organization, I would have been left out in the cold. Crazy enough, this wasn't the only time I've had to make such a transition. I've made several professional changes and have had to learn new skills along the way. Now, I'm not a multimillionaire, nor will my life experiences and exploits fill the pages of history books. I've not accomplished great feats that have been recognized by the world, the United States of America, my hometown, or even my wife. But I have landed jobs with internationally recognized organizations, jobs I had no business landing on paper. And I did it through something as simple and life-changing as reading. The times, they are a-changin'. Over the past 10 years, I've gone through several professional transitions. Here's a snapshot of my seemingly sporadic work experience. Insurance sales, personal and business, retail store manager, pastoral ministry, call center sales representative, copywriting, content management, marketing manager, director of marketing. For many years, I wrestled with the changes I've gone through. When I was in high school, I assumed I would go to college and then work, raise a family, and retire. I had this idea that my life would follow a straight line from beginning to end. Turns out my professional career has looked more like an EKG of a cardiac patient. It's up and down and all over the place. On the one hand, some of my transitions were on purpose. For example, I initially obtained a bachelor's degree in marketing, pursued a career in insurance, and then decided to resign from that line of work to become a pastor. To make this change, I had to make a hard turn professionally. After I resigned from my insurance career, I moved to a different state and participated in an unofficial internship with a local church. This wasn't an easy part of life. From working in a fabric and craft store, to managing an ice cream shop, to waiting tables on nights and weekends, I did whatever I had to do to make ends meet. The apartment I stayed in had faded red shag carpet on the wall and golden lace velvet wallpaper in one of the bathrooms. To this day, I don't know whether or not I should have vacuumed the walls. On the other hand, some of my professional transitions were somewhat out of my control. I left one job in a field I loved to pursue a new adventure before the organization imploded for a variety of reasons. For another job, I did something stupid, well, unwise, and chose to resign from my position because I had stirred up the proverbial hornet's nest. There was a different job I took between transitions that wasn't a good fit at all. It was like I was a square peg being crammed into a round hole, which meant things didn't work out for long. I'm not sure if you've ever found yourself in one of these situations, but it's never a party finding a new job when your back is against the wall. Enter Jeff Brown. Jeff had a similar experience, working at several different jobs instead of maintaining one simple career path. For a brief period in his early 20s, a wonderful coworker took him under his wing and gave him books from Zig Ziglar and Og Mandino to read. He was working on the air at a local radio station and toying with the idea of becoming a radio ad salesman. That's where the quote-unquote real money was at, he was told. These books, he thought, would help him get started. He enjoyed them well enough, but he struggled a great deal with how to apply what he was reading. That, he soon realized, was a separate skill all its own. It didn't help that he wasn't convinced he even wanted to be in sales, real money or not. Turns out he didn't. It would be about 12 years before he picked up another book. During that span, he would hold no fewer than 8 jobs in 3 cities. As long as tenure at any one of them was just 22 months, and he was fired from 5 of them. Partway through, for about 4 years, he changed careers, leaving radio to work in the music business before coming back to radio. In that 4-year span, he worked for 4 record labels. Label 1, 22 months. Label 2, 12 months. Label 3, 12 months. Label 4, 5 weeks. That last stint was actually the one record label he didn't get fired from. Yes, your math is correct. After 3 weeks on the job, he put in his 2 weeks notice. He's not proud of that, and his boss was miffed, but leaving that position for his next job turned out to be one of the best decisions he ever made. He would begin that job in May 2000, but, unlike all the others up to this point, he not only managed to hang on to it for longer than a few months, but would go on to be promoted a total of 6 times in a span of 13 years. And to what does he attribute this turn of events? How did he go from job-hopping maniac to valued employee, one with a disdain for the status quo? Quite simply, he became serious about his own professional growth. More specifically, in 2003, he began a habit of intentional and consistent reading. This habit would also turn out to be largely responsible for instilling in him the confidence to venture out on his own when this last season came to an end in 2013. Your professional career might not look similar to our experience. You may go to college and do one thing, and then figure out that you want to do something else. You may get fired from your job for whatever reason, or you might feel stuck in your current gig without the hope of moving up or moving on. Whatever your career path, you're sure to hit a bump or two along the way. We don't mean to be the bearers of bad news, but gone are the days when you can go to college, work for the same employer, and live in the same town until you retire. We understand this may be the case for some professions, such as nurses, doctors, lawyers, accountants, and teachers, who tend to have a more linear professional development. But most people experience significant career changes. Here are some sobering statistics. The average employee tenure is 4.6 years. The average millennial tenure is less than 3 years. The life expectancy of a company on the S&P 500 is barely 15 years. Add to this the growing trend in the United States workforce toward hiring contingent workers, example, contract, part-time, and you can see that job security is a vapor. Here today, gone tomorrow. You may go through 10 or 15 different jobs during your career. If you're a millennial, this number will most likely be higher. Recent studies discover that millennials will change jobs at least 4 times before they're 32. Our aim in telling you this isn't to dash your dreams against the rocks. Think of it more like us waving smelling salts under your nose to wake you up to the reality most of us will face. It's time to step up and get ready for these new challenges. But where do we start? How can we prepare ourselves for this new economic reality? Simple. We set a new target. Christy Cohn, Assistant Regional Director, FDIC, on The Reading Life. In my mid-20s, reading became a key component of my strategy of becoming better. My career has been in the banking industry, and I read mostly nonfiction in topics of business, economics, personal finance, biographies, history, leadership, and personal growth. But over the years, I have also explored other situational topics depending on my season of life, such as religion and spirituality, grief and loss, relationships, trauma, psychology, and human behavior. I cannot imagine what I would be like without the counsel and instruction from books. I am a functioning adult because of what I've read in books, from personal study, group discussions, and one-on-one interactions, both giving and receiving counsel and advice. It's to a point where in any given conversation, my mind is thumbing through my mental index of books and concepts, and my responses are a composite of decades of learning from others via reading. In the past year, I got a significant promotion at work, the culmination of applying decades of study and learning to prepare me for this role. It's the 4th quarter of my career, and reading books has given me tools, insights, and confidence to finish well. The economic imperative of becoming a lifelong learner. For years, the age-old wisdom in the United States has been this: get a college degree, get a job, start a family, retire. Well, this advice has some merit to it, but today, it's incomplete. At one point in U.S. history, obtaining a college degree would place you in a position to get a job and stay employed with the same company for years. It was important what school you went to and what course of study you pursued. But today, getting a bachelor's degree is merely a prerequisite for many jobs, and you aren't guaranteed to get a job in your field of study. Research has found that 2/3 of college graduates have a job that requires a bachelor's degree, but only 27.3% of these graduates are in a job directly related to their field of study. For example, if you're studying literature, you might find yourself working in advertising. Yeah, probably not what you expected. Getting a college degree is an important first step, but it's not the end. To prepare yourself for the new economic challenges you will face, you need to set your sights on becoming a lifelong learner. This isn't something you can be passive about. According to a recent report by The Economist, lifelong learning is becoming an economic imperative. In other words, we need to be constantly learning. We have to have our eyes on obtaining new skills and gaining different experiences to ensure our professional marketability. A lifelong learner is someone who is self-motivated and committed to gaining new knowledge and skills. You have many ways to accomplish this goal. You can get a new degree, obtain a graduate certificate, or take online courses. At times, some of these options may be best for you and what you want to accomplish, but one of the best, most affordable, and flexible ways you can improve yourself professionally is by reading books. Reading books may not appear on your resume or LinkedIn profile, but the benefits you reap from what you read will. Reading books will help you learn new skills, improve your decision-making abilities, and even provide you with more professional opportunities. Reading books can also help you avoid costly mistakes and reduce your learning curve. If you need help solving a problem, overcoming an obstacle, or getting unstuck, then look for a book on whatever you're going through. Unless you're a glutton for pain and punishment, there's no need to reinvent the wheel if someone else has already gone through what you're going through now. In the words of comedian Groucho Marx, "Learn from the mistakes of others. You can never live long enough to make them all yourself." Think about it like this: on your job or in your business, you will have endless opportunities to learn new things. From mastering new skills to growing in your ability to lead others, every week you will have a chance to grow. Now, will you haphazardly approach these moments with little preparation and reflection? Or will you embrace them by doing what you can and reading whatever book may help you improve yourself? Well, what if we said reading books will boost your performance and help you to work better with others? Would you devote yourself to reading more books? We hope so. If you want to build a successful career or business, then we encourage you to read a lot. Reading is a common habit shared by most successful people throughout history, from Bill Gates, Florence Nightingale, Booker T. Washington, and Warren Buffett to Abraham Lincoln, Margaret Thatcher, Theodore Roosevelt, and Winston Churchill. Many successful people devoted significant amounts of their time to reading books. The benefits of reading are many, yet today people are reading less than before. This growing decline in reading creates an opportunity for you to learn new skills, rise above your competition, and build a successful career by reading books. Over to you. Today is the best day to embrace lifelong learning. Yesterday is gone. Tomorrow isn't guaranteed. Today, the moment you are listening to these words, is the time to pause, reflect, and assess how well you are doing. In other words, it's time to know how many books you've read, are reading, and have left to read during your lifetime. We understand self-assessments can be difficult, and it's never pleasant to talk about the end of your life. But taking the time to calculate how many books you have left to read has a way of focusing your attention. At least this is what Max Joseph discovered. To overcome his bookstore anxiety and read more books, Max Joseph, a filmmaker and television host, shot a short film documenting his quest. For his film, he spoke with a variety of people to help him tackle his TBR, to be read list. One of his interviewees, Tim Urban, shared an insightful lesson that will strike FOMO, fear of missing out, in the heart of anyone who has ever thought about reading more books. In his interview, Tim asked Max how long he might live, barring any unforeseen events, how old he was that day, and how many books he read per year to estimate how many books he would read in his lifetime. When doing the math, Tim allowed Max to feel the weight of his current reading habits so he could see that if he didn't make a change, he would only read 55 more books during the rest of his life. Needless to say, Max wasn't thrilled with the answer to this math equation. This is a helpful exercise and one we encourage you to do right now. Take 2 or 3 minutes to fill in this equation for yourself. Take your life expectancy minus your current age and multiply that number by the number of books you read per year, which will equal the number of books you read in a lifetime. How many books will you read during the rest of your life? Do you feel like gloating about your results, or does it stress you out? For most people, including ourselves, this math equation is enough to light a fire underneath anyone who has a fleeting interest in reading more books. In the following sections, we will share lessons with you to clarify what you need to read, how to read a lot of books, and different strategies you can use to retain and apply what you read. Hopefully, by the end of this book, you'll come back to this equation and feel better about your results. Further reading. These books will lead you into further exploring your professional development. Linchpin, Are You Indispensable? By Seth Godin. How to Win Friends and Influence People by Dale Carnegie. The Call, Finding and Fulfilling God's Purpose for Your Life by Oz Guinness. Extreme Ownership, How U.S. Navy SEALs Lead and Win by Jocko Willink and Leif Babin.
Chapter 2. 8 research-backed reasons why readers do better in their careers. You will be the same person in 5 years as you are today, except for the people you meet and the books you read. Charlie Tremendous Jones. The books you read can transform you, like a chemical reaction in which you add one or more substances together to create one or more different substances. Each book you read is like introducing a new substance into your life that will create something new. From what you believe and the skills you learn to reducing your stress and creating more professional opportunities, reading books will make a life-changing difference. That was the case for me, Jeff. I jumped at the chance to re-enter radio. 4 years in the music business was enough for me. In my new radio job, it wasn't long before I realized how fortunate I was to have been given this chance. The station had a stellar reputation in the industry nationwide. The line of people who would have loved to work at the company was a mile long, and positions like the one I was to fill didn't open up very often. I was to take over the afternoon show from the man who would be my boss, Matt, allowing him to go off the air completely and focus on his managerial duties. Denise, his wife, joked that I was her favorite employee as I helped bring her husband home in time for dinner again. I shuddered to think where I would be in my life and career today if not for Matt and his decision to hire me. Matt is without a doubt the best leader I've ever had the chance to work with. The things he taught me and the values he instilled in me can never be repaid. One of those values was reading. I remember discovering not long after I began working there that members of the leadership team would gather once a week in the conference room and discuss a book they were all reading. I would be at my desk or in the studio during these meetings wondering what their conversations sounded like. What were they discussing? What were they learning? What epiphanies were taking place? What eureka moments might I be missing? Why did I care? Why now? Simply put, this group of people was different. In just a short time, I came to admire them and the product they built. The wider industry admired the company's leadership as well. The culture was one that welcomed ideas from all sides. Standards were high, and learning was ongoing. Much of that learning came from books. This was not something I'd ever heard or seen before. To my knowledge, none of the staff at the companies I'd worked for up to this point, remember it was a lot of companies, were reading books as a means to hone their craft. I was fascinated by the idea that a bunch of radio people from all different backgrounds were intentionally reading business books with the goal of being better employees, better talent, and better humans. And it gradually became clear to me that one of the reasons, if not the main reason, this group of employees led the industry was because they were unwilling to settle. They never assumed they knew or would ever know everything. They avoided the status quo at all costs. They understood the value of inviting in outside mentors, and that one of the easiest and most effective ways to do that was through the right books. This experience helped to get me thinking long-term about my career for really the first time. To borrow a phrase my mom was fond of using in my youth, I was beginning to distinguish my, quote, tail from a hole in the ground. All I knew was I wanted to be in that room. Eventually, I was invited in. I'm not sure what prompted it, but maybe they had grown tired of my ongoing questions about the books being read and the concepts being learned. Hey, squeaky wheel, am I right? My entry into this coveted group could not have been timed any better. Early on,
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.